this. Aspen, what are you talking about?
Every year, the 50 best anglers in the world come together to decide a champion at the Bassmaster Classic.
Give me a pass.
This year, the drama unfolds on Lay Lake in Alabama.
That's what I'm talking about.
Could be sweeter for the winner than a $500,000 purse. The crowning achievement in the sport, the goal of a lifetime realized, and the title of Bassmaster Classic Champion bestowed. It's day two of the Classic.
If you don't know what you're watching, you're watching the Bassmaster Classic, baby! Yeah!
We'll take a look from above at our sweet home for these special 3 days in the outdoors, the biggest 3 days in the outdoors, the Bassmaster Classic 2007, the World Championship of Bass Fishing. We're underway with round number two. There are the conditions right there. The air temperature, a little chilly in the 40s, going to move up into the 50s and 60s. The wind will be gusting out there today. Some big winds. Tommy Sanders here with Mark Zona, fished his share of tournaments. I know you don't like wind so much, but maybe the biggest thing in the minds of these guys is the fact that it is day number two. That's important.
Definitely. And, you know, the wind, it's going to affect the fishermen more than it is the fish. I mean, these fish are going to bite. They're going to bite all day long. But today is the day. If you're in the top 25, you're moving on to tomorrow. You're going to fish for $500,000. Well, if you're in the bottom 25, you're hanging with Zona and Sanders at the Bassmaster Classic Outdoor Show. Not so much fun.
You don't want to be there so much. Let's take a look at the big story so far in this Classic 2007 from day one. Our surprise leader, I guess you could say, Boyd Duckett of Alabama, had a great stringer of fish anchored by that huge one right there, 8 pounds, 2 ounces.
And this is the Alabama who's who of bass fishing right now. Gerald Swindle, local. Another guy, Randy Howell, fishing way up on the tail race. And a guy in there that you've got to keep your eye on right now, Timmy Horton. He had a mix of spotted bass and largemouth.
Anytime we talk about the Classic, for the last 5 years especially, we are talking about this man, Michael Iaconelli.
Number one best quote of the tournament so far. Zona, day one was a success for one reason. I did not get DQ'd.
Let's take a look at our leaderboard so far. Round two underway, and Boyd Duckett still hanging on top there, but it's very early in the day. Lots of other Alabama names we recognize there. Randy Howell, Timmy Horton, Alabama showing up well in this Bassmaster Classic. Let's take a look at our Toyota rules of the game. We're playing by them all 3 days of competition. We start with 50 competitors, 50 fishing through the first 2 days. We cut the field to 25 on the final day. 5 fish limit every day for each angler. You have to fish within the boundaries of the lake. The highest 3 day total wins the $500,000. Let's take a look again at our playing field, Lay Lake near Birmingham, Alabama, on the Coosa River chain, famous for bass fishing. I'm going to take you down to that lake and take a look at the 5 leaders from round number one, where they were fishing during that round. Boyd Duckett, Timmy Horton, not too far from our launch at Paradise Point Marina. Ditto for Terry Scroggins. And then we go way up the lake.
Two people you got to keep your eye on right now, Skeet Reese and Randy Howell, way up the lake.
We got some strategy reports from up on the lake. Byron Velvick is standing by with it.
Thanks a lot, Tommy. We're 31 miles north of the launch up here at the beginning of Lay Lake. Behind me, the turbines that a lot of these guys talked about yesterday. They want that water flowing. They want that current. Well, that's exactly what we got up here this second morning. The water's moving through here, and those big spotted bass especially love to feed in the current. When the water's up there and the water's coming down, they get up on those banks and they start flipping those jigs. And I know a lot of guys will be thrilled to see this happening up here. So looks to be a great second day up here at the top of Lay Lake. Mary, what's going on down south?
Thanks, Byron. I'm out here at Kelly Branch. We're probably about a mile away from the launch ramp. Now, I was talking to Boyd Duckett earlier, who's in the lead after day one, and he said that he's going to come out here and start fishing in these nice, shallow flats. What Boyd wants to do is he wants to catch his limit early and then go out and get after those big ones so he can hold on to that lead. Back to you.
And this lake is completely revolved around current. We've got a dam way up on the upper end of the lake where Byron was at. And what that does, that lets water into the lake. We have a dam at the bottom end of the lake, and that lets water out. What happens is it creates a very heavy current flow. And I know this is going to sound crazy, but these fish are programmed to know exactly when this happens. When there's no current, they kind of just scatter out. They're alone. They run solo. But when that current starts moving, that's when they congregate together. They get shallow and they get in position to feed.
All right. Current is a big part of it. For each and every one of these 50 anglers out there trying to make the top 25, we're going to take you down to a place called Spring Creek, just south of our launch area. And Dean Rojas, originally from California, now fishing out of Texas, trying hard to make that top 25 a very recognizable spot. Fished with him in practice. He caught two spotted bass right here at this spot.
And here's a perfect case of current. He's fishing right in the mouth of a bridge, okay? That's a funnel. Current's going to funnel through there, and that's what a lot of these guys are concentrating on, is wherever water funnels through.
Take a look now at our day one. Well, hold on. There he is right there. We're going to get him catching this fish.
All right. Good start. Nice 3-pound spot. Number one. On our way.
All right, now our day one leader. We leave Dean Rojas there in Spring Creek. We're going to go back upriver to Boyd Duckett. Boyd Duckett caught that huge bass again on day number one. What's he working on?
Well, here's the amazing thing about Boyd Duckett. He said, I am not fishing for the more plentiful spotted bass. I'm only going to fish for largemouth bass. Now, this is a home run style of fishing. You can literally knock one out of the park, or you can completely strike out.
There he is.
Little tiny one. On the board, baby.
All right, Boyd Duckett staying on the board, staying on top of that leaderboard for now. Remember, all these weights we're going to show you right now are unofficial. Nothing's official until we get to the weigh-in. Now up over to Timmy Horton. I know you like Timmy Horton and his chances in this tournament.
I really do. And more than anything, Timmy said he is catching giant spotted bass in the morning.
There he is. Big spot. Big spot. Oh, this is a giant. Oh, this is a giant. Stay hooked up, fish. Second cast of the day. Please stay hooked. This is a giant. Big spot.
You gotta loosen your drag, you ain't. These fish will run on you so fast at the boat.
Two of them. Look at here. Two of them. Two of them. 2 4-pounders. Unbelievable. Unbelievable.
Unbelievable. Oh, my goodness. If that ain't the way to start a day.
Look at this.
You think they're up there? Very rarely do you land both of them when that happens.
Look at this.
Folks, I'm going to tell you what. The Coosa River is the only place you'll see stuff like this happen.
Wow, how about that?
First time.
Guy's a disheveled mess this morning.
Absolutely. First time we've ever seen a twofer in competition, on TV at least, in the Bassmaster Classic, and that is big for Timmy Horton. Moves him all the way up there into second place. Boyd Duckett holding on to that lead, but very tenuous for right now. There's so much fishing on the way. We are going to take a break, and when we come back, we got plenty to show you, not just from the lake, but from New Orleans. Plenty of stories of despair still coming out of New Orleans, but more than a year after, we show you a story of an amazing rescue.
Did I really want to do it? No. I mean, because I was, you know, I was scared to do it, but it was like something that I had to do. So regardless, I was going to put that aside and do it.
Chances are also you have no idea just how tough pro fishermen really are. These athletes compete in all weather, including some rough rides during windy conditions, stuff like we have out there today.
You don't want to go out there, you know, but what drives you is that competitive factor.
Oh, no.
And you never know what Mike Iaconelli's going to do, which Michael Iaconelli shows up this year, the one disqualified from the Classic last year, or the one who won Angler of the Year. Hey, don't go anywhere. Plenty on the way.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of the Bassmaster Classic is brought to you by Mercury Marine. Mercury, number one on the water. Pure later. Pure oil now, pure oil later. The all-new Toyota Tundra, the truck that's changing it all. And by Advance Auto Parts, providing car care know-how to protect your investment. We're ready in advance.
The city of Pittsburgh provided a spectacular backdrop for the 2005 Classic, but the Three Rivers also proved to be the toughest fishery in Classic history, with the biggest bass caught weighing less than 2 pounds.
It's a survival deal. It's a deal whoever can catch, you know, five fish or the most fish every day is going to win this tournament.
After finishing as the runner-up in two of the last 3 years, second-round leader Aaron Martins hoped this would finally be his year.
I just had a bad tournament, really, to tell you the truth. I lost more fish than I ever have, and I actually hooked fish and lost them, so I should have won it, but that's fishing, you know?
In the end, Michigan's Kevin Van Dam edged Martins by a scant 6 ounces.
Yes! Good fish.
His winning weight was an all-time low, but Van Dam was now a two-time Classic champion.
Opened in 1910, Birmingham's Rickwood Field is America's oldest standing baseball park. Through the years, some of the greatest players in baseball history have played here, including Babe Ruth, Ty Cobb, and Willie Mays, who grew up just minutes from this historic park. You're watching our coverage of the historic 2007 Bassmaster Classic, taking now out to Lay Lake, and Randy Howell was right in the thick of it.
Boys catching real good up here, and the key a lot of times when the water is not high, when it's low, you fish out, you catch the fish off the stuff you don't see. You throw up there in a visible area that looks good, but then you work it out. And a lot of my bites yesterday were coming way out off the shore.
It's
underneath that tree. See if he's still on there. I think I hooked him that time.
There he comes. Oh, it's a big one. That's a big one. Yeah. There we go, boys.
He ate it, didn't he?
Yeah!
A 3-pounder.
Put him in the big boy side.
Y'all thought I was hung up, didn't he? Yeah, y'all said he ain't got no fish.
Randy Howell making that sweet spot, still working for him in day number two. Now over to Terry Scroggins, another one of our top five from round one competition. Terry Scroggins, Palatka, Florida. The strategy here, you're fishing for two different kinds of bass, largemouth and spotted bass. Mark Zona, please explain the difference.
Well, I'm going to start with the spotted bass right now. And anybody that's fished the Coosa River, they know exactly what I'm talking about. They're one of the strongest fish you'll ever find. They live in current their whole life. They're very strong. They have to fight that current from day one. But they're very moody, they're very finicky, they're hard to figure out, Tommy. You know, one day they're in one spot, the next day and they're in another spot. You can't keep track. Here's how I'm gonna describe a spotted bass. We've all dated somebody like a spotted bass. Yeah, totally hot, completely nuts, bro.
Guess that says it all. Spotted bass, largemouth bass, looks like a spotted bass for Terry Scroggins.
Whew, man, I guess, a 2-pound spot or so. Slow start this morning, but hopefully we get ready to get started.
See what I mean?
Terry Scroggins right there with the shaky head rig. Hey, Mark Zona's going to show us how to make that shaky head rig pay off for you. Let's learn right now how to fish like a pro.
You know, the great thing about fishing a shaky head is you can catch some big fish, but the biggest thing is you're going to get a lot of bites. You're going to put fish in the live well. Now, the biggest key is that little dude right there, the lead head jig. What it does different is when you rig this thing up, you come in about a quarter inch, thread it up the line, and then spin it around and come right back through the worm. The deal with this, it stands straight up all the time. It always sets like this, and it sits there and entices the bass. Now, the one thing you can do with this, if you look behind me and you see what's going on here, we got a lot of rock, we got a lot of wood. That's where that dude right there really excels. Guaranteed, in this tournament, they're gonna smash him on this bait right here.
There he is, good one too.
And that's the deal. All you're trying to do is get that bait on the bottom.
That's a nice little keeper.
And somewhere through this tournament, that little worm right there is gonna catch a bunch of those bass.
Mark Zona and the word on the shaky head. Let's take a look at the word on the street. What's happening out there? Our bass tracker tells us that now we have one of our Federation Nation anglers, Terry McWilliams, on top of the leaderboard. Some fantastic stuff, a new development. We'll talk about that surely in the moments to come. Boyd Duckett, Steve Kennedy of Alabama, Randy Howell as well, Timmy Horton, the rest of that top five are all Alabamans. Got so much shaking out there on Lay Lake, but right now let's take you back. More than a year after Hurricanes Katrina and Rita devastated the Louisiana Gulf Coast, we still hear stories of despair and loss, but right now, a story of heroism. The story of Greg Hackney, who used his fishing boat to rescue his stranded father-in-law.
This is a national disaster. This is a major, major, major deal. People are dying. They don't have homes. They don't have jobs. The city of New Orleans will never be the same.
On the morning of August 29th, 2005, as the surge of Hurricane Katrina's 23-foot waves hit his New Orleans warehouse, Greg Hackney's father-in-law, Andy Hillary, stood in the semi-darkness, helpless, defiant, and scared.
I spent two nights in this building with my Rottweilers protecting me. Cell phones didn't work, period. There was no power. There were no fans. There was no light. As I would go to bed at night, you'd hear gunshots. It was lawlessness. The fear that you felt, you just couldn't imagine it.
Refusing to become a victim of the chaos around him, Hillary figured his best chance was to walk out. He hoped his son-in-law, who lives 45 miles north of New Orleans, could rescue him by boat. On an overpass, he finally found phone service and some unwanted attention.
I was on the phone talking to my wife. When I turned around, they backed up and said, give me your telephone. I said, man, I can't give you my telephone. He reaches in his car and he pulls out a pistol and he sticks a pistol in my face and he says, give me your telephone or I'm gonna kill you. Goodbye, telephone.
After another sleepless night back in his warehouse with gunfire all around him, Hillary was finally able to call out on another phone. He asked Hackney to meet him the next morning at a prearranged location on Lake Pontchartrain South Shore, 5 miles away.
Everybody's on pins and needles at home. You know, here I've left to go get him. You know, there's no way to talk to him by phone, radio, whatever. They don't know if I'm gonna come back with him. They don't know if I'm gonna make it back.
Just the unknown, the fear of the unknown. I think anybody would react the same way, you know, if they thought they might lose someone.
You're fearing for your life because of the lawlessness. You're trying to hide. You don't know who's in the area.
I was scared to do it, but it was like something that I had to do. So regardless, I was going to put that aside and do it, you know, because that's my job. You know, that's what I was supposed to do.
He was just like looking over the horizon to see whether anybody else was going to come up. I was waving at my towel like crazy, and when I saw him start coming in, it was like just a relief.
It was overwhelming for me because there was so much anxiety. Was he going to be there or not? And so when I actually figured out, you know, he was there and got him in the boat, you know, it was pretty emotional for me.
I cried. I hugged that boy. That's the best bass fish he ever caught. Me.
In my heart, I sit back and think, wow, you know, that was really great.
Just an incredible story. Greg Hackney, one of the top guys in the sport, and so many of these guys have ties to that area.
They do. You know, the week that happened, I remember hearing a story of so many professional bass fishermen that went down there and helped. I mean, it was a great deal.
All right, let's keep it going. We got much more on the way. When we come back, we're going to be talking about Michael Iaconelli. Would he like to forget last year's classic? Probably so. Lost fish and an emotional meltdown of sorts that got him disqualified, but he rose from that and had a triumphant 2006 season. We got that and so much more on the way. All eyes are on the starting line as the coverage of the NHRA Powerade Series continues on ESPN2 with the Checkers, Shucks, Cragen Nationals. Join new announcer Paul Page and analyst Mike Dunn for the CarQuest Auto Parts Winter Nationals on ESPN2. Qualifying coverage Saturday at midnight Eastern and finals coverage Sunday at 7 Eastern. Bassmaster Classic 2007, right in the thick of it. Elimination Day, round number two. You got to be in the top 25. And look at the top of our leaderboard. One of the anglers who came up through the Federation Nation program. Basically an amateur angler. They get to compete in this top bass fishing program in the world. And Terry McWilliams of Indiana is the man on top. Some amazing, amazing stuff out there. Mike Iaconelli, we're looking for him on that leaderboard. He's bubbling just beneath it. For Mike Iaconelli, a memorable year last year. He'd probably like to forget how it started. Day one of last year's Classic, he was disqualified for unsportsmanlike conduct for this meltdown after he discovered dying fish in his live well. Iaconelli came back with a vengeance, had his best season ever on the Bassmaster Elite Series with four top 10 finishes in 11 events, including one tournament win. Iaconelli ends the season with his first Angler of the Year title.
It just couldn't have played out better for me this year. You know, it was a rough start for me, and I worked and I worked and I kept focused, and I battled through some tough events, and it's amazing. I'm speechless.
What an Angler of the Year race it was, and Mike Iaconelli, the man on top. There he is, just above Steve Kennedy, another contender in this tournament, along with Kevin Van Dam, who's trying to crawl back into the top of the leaderboard. Aaron Martin, Dean Rojas, they're all in it as well. The cream rises to the top when you come to the Bassmaster Classic. You want to get out on the lake, watch a little Ike in action right now? Let's do that. Leave Paradise Point Marina. That's our launch point. We're going south down the lake. Well, 4 or 5, maybe about 7 miles to Iaconelli's little spot, a bay down there. Well, he's keeping on. He's going on. It's a beautiful spot, and he caught him there yesterday. He's back again today.
And one of the things I said at the top of the show, I was dead serious about. Mike got done weighing in yesterday, and he said, Zona, I had a decent day on the water, but it was a success. I'm still in the tournament.
Right now, I'm trying to catch my limit here, and if things don't shape up, I've got to switch, because these aren't the fish that's going to get me to where I need to be. But I'd like to start with a limit, settle me down a little bit. That wouldn't be a bad deal. It calms you down, settles you down. Settles your nerves, you know. Take a worm, Berkeley worm, 6-inch. Write it down, make it real small, even smaller. Take a 6-inch worm, make it about a 3-inch worm. Don't worry, guys, I'm a professional. Keep throwing, you figure one of these times is gonna be a big one. I think the big ones live here. You know, we just haven't been fortunate enough yet to get that big bite, but I think it's hard to believe that they school by size, you know. I think they're just in here. There's a lot of fish in here. It's just a matter of getting that bite.
Keep throwing, he says. Is it purely a numbers game? What's he doing here?
Well, here's the best way to describe what he's doing. He's building momentum, and in the Bassmaster Classic, that is the biggest thing you want to do. Build momentum in the morning, then start upgrading your catch after you catch 5. Now, the one thing we're seeing transpire, the quality is coming up the lake. Everybody said the largemouth, they're going to outweigh all the spotted bass. But so far this morning, all the footage that's being brought into us, Tommy, the spotted bass are way outsizing the largemouth.
When you look at this spot where we find Skeet Reese, that looks like spotted bass country to you, right?
Wherever the folks at home see this very heavy current, okay, wherever that very heavy current is rolling down the river, that's where all your spotted bass guys are fishing. Coincidentally, that's where most of your leaders are fishing.
Skeet Reese from Auburn, California, made it in third position yesterday. He's got a good one in the boat today. Skeet Reese is on a roll.
That's what I want. Bassmasters Classic, $500,000 on the line, the most prestigious title in bass fishing. And I'm in contention to win this game. And when you get bites like that, it gets you pretty fired up.
Over to Wagner, Oklahoma's Tommy Biffle. Another one of these guys who's had all the second place finishes in the Classic they want. Tommy Biffle fishing to win this one right here.
Tommy's one of the most dangerous fishermen in the field. He is a home run hitter. Tommy is going to be at the top of your leaderboard, or unfortunately, the complete bottom of your leaderboard.
I started right here yesterday morning. Skeet wasn't even around the corner up there yet when we first saw him. And I pull up here this morning, he's sitting right on one of my best stretches. So I've lost a lot of respect for him for that, and, you know, it's a bad deal. I guess that's the way he wants to be, then that's the way it is.
Now, Tommy Sanders, pretty much every hardcore bass fisherman across the country right now is saying, yeah, I ran into that. But more than anything, people that don't fish, this happens, man. These guys get territorial. When they're at the top, they want to claim all the water around them.
And at classic time, all those nerve endings a little bit more sensitive.
Ah, dang it, that's a 3-pounder, it looked like. Dang it. Dadgummit.
All right, let's take a look at that leaderboard right now. We're going to take a look at the full leaderboard. 50 anglers out there fishing today. Only 25 will make it to championship day, day number 3 of this classic. Terry McWilliams of Indiana, former law enforcement officer, an amateur angler at the top of the leaderboard. He will cherish this moment for many, many years to come.
And you got to start keeping your eye on, a lot of our veterans are not in the top right now. Our Kevin Van Dams, you know, our Rick Lunds, our Denny Browers, guys that were supposed to be great in this tournament, not in the top 20. Right now,
Texan Matt Reed is the man on the bubble. Russ Lane of Alabama, a pre-tournament favorite, right now, if they shut the thing down, would not make the top 25.
And more than anything, the top 25 projected cut right now, if you were to guess, is going to be around 20 to call it about 23 pounds. That's going to be the magic line to move on to fish for $500,000.
There's the bottom of the leaderboard. These guys have got to kick.
They're hanging with us tomorrow.
Unfortunately, we may be seeing plenty of those guys walking around the hotel tomorrow. When we come back, hey, the good news is so many of our great characters out here, the guys who make it a show, are still in contention. Ish Monroe, Michael Iaconelli, all the rest. It's called entertainment, and we got plenty of it on the way. The Bassmaster Classic 2007, day 2 action going on right now. A very important day, and right at the top of the leaderboard, we look at Terry McWilliams from the state of Indiana, came up with the Bassmaster Federation Nation System, one of our amateur anglers. That's one of the great things about the Bassmaster Classic. These guys get a shot at the top title in the world of fishing. Some amazing stuff going on out there. The fishing continues out there on the lake. Man, Mark Zona, Tommy Sanders here. This is the big one, $500,000 to the winner.
That sounded good right there. Federation Nation angler fishing for $500,000.
Would that be something?
But in all honesty, you know, we talked about it at the top of the show, this is elimination day. Trust me, the bottom 25 guys, they do not want to be hanging out tomorrow off the water.
Some guys taking desperate measures out there right now. We need to take another look at our playing field. We're going to take you out to Lay Lake. This place has hosted the Classic twice in 1996 and 2002 right there in Alabama, just between the Talladega Speedway and the city of Birmingham. You find Lay Lake on the Coosa River. About 289 miles of shoreline, 48 miles long, and 12,000 acres. Seems small, but everyone's telling us this place is fishing big. Take a look at our weather report for the second day of competition. The air temperature has warmed up a little bit, into the 50s, a little more comfortable. The wind persistent, 12 to 15 miles an hour. We were worried about that. It doesn't seem to be bothering these guys just a whole lot.
Well, the wind's blowing right now, but I'm telling you, they're forecasting for very heavy winds later on in the day into Sunday, 20 to 30 mile per hour winds.
All right, we talk about weather and we talk about anglers. These guys, well, they fish in just about any sort of conditions. You know, they don't call games here. They don't have rain outs. You don't get a rain check. These guys go, whether it's hail, sleet, or snow. Take a look at this.
It can get bad. Get real bad.
Make sure we really want to go fishing today.
I can get brutal. You could be on the Great Lakes and it'd be 7 and 8 footers and you literally can't stand up.
I think through each wave, you're kind of questioning what you're doing.
I gotta say, I'm scared.
I mean, scared. Like, scared for my life, scared.
It can be snowing in a high 35 and it's snowing sideways.
You lose your feelings in your fingers and your toes. Those are the two main things that you can't keep warm. Once you start concentrating on that instead of the fishing, then you got a problem.
The one thing that really scares me, though, is like,
you know, one over here, one over there.
Where are you gonna go?
Oh, man.
With that kind of lightning, you're dead.
It can get to the point where it comes down, and I really sincerely mean this, where it separates the men from the boys, who wants it, who don't.
Knowing that you have to get up on and compete on a day where it's, you know, sub-zero temperatures and wind, and it's miserable, it's cold, you don't want to go out there.
You know, if we're all sitting there shaking and freezing,
good God,
and nobody can think, if one person can put it together and fight through that, he's going to beat you.
Weather's fine right now. These guys coping with it perfectly. Some heavy weather, some of that bad stuff they were talking about coming in after the competition today through the night. The results of that's what you're worried about.
Well, I really don't think that wind is going to be the problem on Sunday. I really think the big problem is going to be heavy rains before the day on Sunday. Well, the reason why, we're on a river system, and guaranteed heavy rains is going to affect some of our leaders' water. And what it's going to do, it's going to muddy their water up. If it muddies their water up, game over.
All right. One of the guys fishing up at the top of the river there, not too far from the Logan Martin Dam, is Randy Howell of Alabama. He has found a super good spot. This guy has been in the leader, the top five, all the way through this tournament. He is sitting in a good place.
And the one key factor to Randy's success right now, he's been very vocal about it. He said, I need that water coming in from Lake Logan Martin. I need it coming in, creating that current, pushing these spots. Spotted bass up shallow.
Woo! There we go. He about got me sleeping, didn't he? Old jig got him there, boy. Come on. Go ahead.
Wow.
Gerald Swindle right through the middle of Randy Howell's stuff. What did we just see here?
Well, you know, more than likely, 99.9% chance, that's the river channel. That's the deepest part he could run his boat. Now, was he practicing safety right there, Tommy? I'm not going to go there. There is one thing I will tell you. I would probably talk with him after the tournament after that.
A lot of mitigating factors there. The depth of the water, whether he has to keep it on plane or not. We don't know the whole story just yet. Gerald Swindle, well, we'll hear what he thinks about that incident right there.
It's like constipated. Sometimes you just got to commit sitting in there. Something happens. You can wait it out.
And the one thing we're seeing, though, the guys on the upper end of Lay Lake, they are smashing them this morning. You're noticing tons of current coming through, and it seems everybody on the upper end of the lake, they've almost got their limits already. They're going to start culling.
Gerald Swindle, one of the most flamboyant characters on the Bassmasters. Still looking for his first win with the Bassmasters, although he has notched an Angler of the Year as well. He would like nothing better than to win this classic.
I bet you they got wet when I come by. Nothing I can do, man. I had to go. I'm sorry about that, but I had to go, guy. Randy was waving me on through. He knew I'm coming.
All right, that's his explanation right there.
Well, yeah, that's his explanation right there. I'm not going to say it's the safest thing in the world, and that's pretty much what I'm going
to
say about that.
Not for us to judge at this point. Right. I think a lot of people are going to say, and you say Randy Howell might have some words with him when they get back to weigh-in time.
Well, that may happen.
All right, you want to take a look at the leaderboard right now. This Bassmaster Classic Day 2. See if Terry McWilliams is hanging in there. He is our Federation Nation angler, still getting it done. Boyd Duckett, our Day 1 leader, right behind him there. And a Kevin Van Dam has slipped in our top five right there. We say never take your eyes off KVD, and there he is. He's going to make himself a factor in this Day 2 competition. Looks like he's in. He's in all the way for the top 25.
It sure
is. We'll get into that a little bit later as well. We got a lot more on the way. When we come back, catching fish for a living sounds like fun. Being a pro angler, though, takes a lot of personal sacrifice. Skeet Reese and his wife talk candidly about the toll his career takes on their marriage when we return.
Get mommy.
It's hard. I think it's harder.
Some tuna?
Now that we have kids. I don't count the days he's gone, I count the days before he comes home.
Bassmaster Classic 2007 coming to you from Birmingham, Alabama. There's one of the big landmarks of Birmingham, that Statue of Vulcan. That Statue of Vulcan is the largest human figure ever cast in iron. Very appropriate in this steel city of Birmingham, Alabama, sitting on his perch. They're in Vulcan Park. Took a trip to the World's Fair in St. Louis back in 1904, lost his shield and his spear back in that
time. Amazing, Tommy.
Some big things happening in Birmingham with this classic out on the lake right now. See if big things are happening for Ish Monroe, the angler from the Bay Area of California. Grew up in the big town, learned how to bass fish, had a great 2006 season, a breakthrough season, bookended with victories.
And one of the things we got to stress with these guys is really the importance of one fish. What one fish could mean, okay? And I mean that in the tense of positive momentum and very, very negative momentum. You catch a fish like this. Ish Monroe has this on right here. If he lands that, that could make great decision making for the rest of the event. If you lose a fish like that, your head kind of goes in a tailspin. I can relate to that. I know you can too right now, certainly. But more than anything, it creates a negative spiral, man, and you really can't recover if you lose a bass like that.
Four-day tournaments is what these guys fish in the Elite Series. Even more important, not to have that sort of loss of concentration in a three-day tournament.
Definitely, Tommy. And one of the biggest things is, you know, guys like Ish Monroe, Tommy Biffle, they've been there before. They kind of know how to handle it better than your average, you know, weekend fisherman if they lose a fish. But trust me, somewhere in this tournament, this will be won or lost on a key fish.
Tommy Biffle had a great round one, having a little bit of a struggle in round number two here.
Got to be the boat traffic got them messed up, don't it? That wasn't nobody but us up here yesterday. Yesterday, I didn't hardly miss any, and today, I missed them and lost them, like they're not taking the jig good.
Biffle there trying to get something going as we take a look at our leaderboard. And now the man from Alabama, our day one leader, has clawed his way back to the top of the list. Boyd Duckett of Demopolis, Alabama, back in this thing. Kevin Van Dam giving close chase. There's a situation you're not going to take your eyes off of. Jerry McWilliams, our Federation Nation angler. And Skeet Reese, man, what a great classic he is having. Yet Skeet Reese last night from his daughter received a prediction on his chances here that was a little bit unsettling.
My oldest girl, Leah, is four. She crushed my heart last night. And we were sitting in the hotel room, and I asked her, is Daddy gonna win? And she goes, no. And I'm just like, what? She goes, how come I can't win? She goes, because you catch the little fish.
Issues of family and fishermen. People think it's a great job, and of course it is a great job, sport fishing for a living, but it involves a lot of days on the road every year, as much as 250 days a year. You got stress to deal with out on the road in competition, and then stress to deal with when Daddy comes back home. It's always a problem-solving issue, and they're solving problems always in the Skeet Reese household.
Last time everybody heard about you on television, you were still in Mommy's tummy. And I was at Kentucky Lake.
It's Father's Day. My wife's due. And I don't want to miss my girl being born.
America, this is Courtney Renreese. And I made it home in time. You know, being a professional bass fisherman, there's nothing easy about it. And for me, I would say my average year is between 200 and 250 days on the road each year. And the hardest part is just the time away from family.
It's hard. I think it's harder now that we have kids because I see the struggles that they have. So I don't count the days he's gone. I count the days before he comes home.
When I'm gone for a month and I come home, I'm an outsider. And when Leah doesn't open up to me and doesn't want to play with me, it hurts. It really does. I mean, it's one of the most painful things that I experience still to this day is Leah not letting me in.
It's just the readjustment. It's the readjustment of him coming home and him not knowing the routine. And then comes
Leah's personal playground.
The anticipation of him leaving again. So then you go through that, and then you go through the survival mode that you're in when he's gone.
My respect for her has changed tenfold. And I was pretty hard on her at times. And she snapped back and, you know, she wasn't happy with me. But as I started realizing how difficult it is and how much time and energy is needed to put into raising a child, whatever she gets done, beautiful. However she does it, beautiful, because I know how much energy she's putting into our children. And that's priceless to me.
People think that marriage is so easy. There's nothing about marriage that's easy. It's almost its own job.
And you have to learn how to work things out and work through things. And, you know, if you're both willing to work together, you can do it. We have found a way to make it work. And I hope it stays that way.
Great job on some fronts, yeah. Tough job on other fronts. You've been around all these guys. You spend a lot of time with them. You recognize a lot of the things in the Reese story there.
Well, definitely, you know, and one of the biggest things that people think, I mean, if they don't follow professional bass fishing, they think that, wow, these guys get to go fishing on the weekend, come hang out Monday to Friday. Mm-hmm. But that's not the case. When they leave in January, they're basically gone till October, you know. It's kind of a case of careful what you wish for, I would say, you know. And not only that, it's pretty much, you know, it's a professional career. But these guys don't make $7.1 million a year like a, you know, an NFL quarterback or something like that, where it softens the blow a little bit.
Right. They're one-man contractors, a one-man show, and sometimes it gets tough. We're going to come back to round number one. Think about Kevin Van Dam and his struggles. But we always say never take your eyes off of Kevin Van Dam, and he's making it happen in round number two. We'll find out how he's doing it when we come back.
The Big Easy played host to the 2003 Classic, but it was this boisterous kid from New Jersey who stole the show.
Classic number two, here I come! Oh my God, it's the winner.
During the final minutes of the final day, Mike Iaconelli caught a huge 3.5-pound bass.
A freak, straight up freak.
That's my personality, you know. I'm a very exuberant, excited type of person, and in everything I do.
Iaconelli's classic victory propelled his popularity and gave pro fishing a new poster boy.
Great classic 2003 to 2007 classic rolls on. More coverage coming your way 8:30 a.m. Sunday morning on ESPN2. And the big final, day three action, the championship round, 10 p.m. Eastern time, Sunday night. We'll crown a winner. Somebody's going to win $500,000, and their life will be changed by winning the biggest event in fishing. Take a look at Lay Lake. That's the site of our classic. Boyd Duckett, the Alabaman. Maybe many people not picking him coming into this, but boy, he's been strong so far in this classic. Still on top at 11 a.m. Central Time, the second day of competition. Kevin Van Dam, just about everybody picking him coming in here, and he has fulfilled his expectations. Kevin Van Dam hanging right in there. Terry McWilliams, the Federation Nation angler, and Skeet Reese right there in fourth place. The angler from California is having himself a fantastic classic. Let's go out on Lay Lake. Take a look at Skeet Reese. Skeet Reese from Auburn, California, hasn't had a win with the Bassmasters in a good long while. Needs to get it picked up and win one here, and the classic would be a good one.
And the one thing, if you look back to day one, 11 o'clock to 1 o'clock, that's really when the damage was done. There was a ton of bass caught early in the day, but the bulk of the better bites came later in the day.
That's five, baby. I ain't getting whoppers today, but you gotta start with five and go from there. Don't let me catch four more big ones, because then it's really gonna get ugly in here.
From Skeet Reese over to Michael Iaconelli, made his way to the front part of that leaderboard right now. And Michael Iaconelli, the 2006 Angler of the Year with the Bassmasters, had a great year coming back from a tough start with a bad classic last year.
There's a lot of fish here. I seen them on the graph, dude. And look at them. They're right under the boat, too. I mean, I'm on a spot right here, brother. They're all spotted bass, too. Big one. Big one. Go, big one. There's a 3-pound spot. They are spot good. We need to back up. Big spot. Don't want to lift it. Right there, what you got, we're in about 24 foot of water, and that black spot you see at the bottom is bait. So we're sitting on a point. What's happening here is this wind is blowing at a perfect angle, and it's kind of sweeping these clouds of bait across this point. And there's apparently some schools of spots out here that are chasing this bait fish, but they're not focused on one area. They're roaming. And so what I'm trying to do here now is relocate the school. We had the school going. We caught three in a row, four in a row, and then they stopped because basically the school has moved on. And so hopefully, I'm hoping that they're just kind of moving up and down these points.
And right now, Mike Iaconelli is the only angler we've seen so far fishing offshore structure. He's using that depth finder as his eyes to find the school.
Another big one. Another big one.
Big one.
Oh, big one. Oh, big spot.
Look out. I'm on him now. Look out, guys. I'm on him now. It's over. It's on. Don't let me see fish on the graph like that. Don't let me do that.
Wow. Seen that look before from Michael Iaconelli. We may have witnessed one of the big turning points of this Bassmaster Classic. Michael Iaconelli in sixth place now as we look at our full leaderboard. Tommy Biffle, the Oklahoman, having overtaken again Boyd Duckett of Alabama at the top of the leaderboard. Terry Scroggins making a big move as well. Take a look at page number two. Alton Jones from Texas in there. Royce Dennington, another Federation Nation angler, much improved from his day one performance there. Dean Rojas trying to get in there, trying to make the top 25. You have to do that.
And right now, the magic cut line setting just over 20 pounds. The guys underneath 25th place, Tommy, they're all headed home. Jared Littner, very scary shape right now.
The angler from California, Derek Rimmitz, he'll be fishing the Bassmaster Series this year. Takahiro Amori, a former classic champ. Boy, they've got to work hard to make it into that cut line, and they don't have too much time with which to do it. Just over 3.5 hours fishing time left remaining. These fellas are going to have to pray for a miracle. These guys on the last page of the leaderboard, we won't be seeing them till the weigh-in, and maybe they can bring in something that astounds us. We'll just have to wait and see. We got the weigh-in coming up for you later on today. When we come back, we'll take a look at this one more time. We've seen it already. This move by Gerald Swindle, the Alabama angler, going right through Randy Howell's area right there. In fact, between the spectators and his camera boat. There could be a ruling on this coming up. Bassmaster Classic 2007, the top event in the sport of competitive bass fishing. That was the scene at the launch. Day two of this three-day competition, elimination day. We take the field down from 50 to 25 who will fish on championship day. Of this field of 50 anglers, 36 of them have graduated, qualified to the Classic on the basis of their performance in something called the Elite Series. 14 tournaments, very tough competition, and it's definitely got a special flavor. Take a look.
Oh, my gosh. Come and get you some of that!
Get you some of that! Ah!
Oh.
Woo! Bam! Oh!
With the joint.
Ah! Gotcha!
Oh, 13 pounds. And Mike Iaconelli moves to the top of the food chain.
These guys are the best in the world, but they had to fish about twice as many tournaments to prove it this year, 2006. It's been grueling. These guys have been through the ringer.
That's the right word to you. It was grueling covering it, Tommy.
Not that bad.
But in all honesty, it was the first year ever fishing, professional bass fishing, ran almost the entire year. More than that, the Elite Series, what makes it so special, it's so hard to qualify for.
All right, let's get back to the thing they've been working for, the 2007 Bassmaster Classic. Take a look at our conditions right now as we pick up the fishing. 60 degrees, our air temperature. We made it to the 60s, hooray. Water temperature there still in the low 50s, and the wind holding steady 12 to 15 miles an hour. Take a look at the leaderboard, who's been making the big moves out there, and there is constant
constant moving. Again, these guys trying to make that top 25. Tommy Biffle back on top there. Boyd Duckett of Alabama. Terry Scroggins, another guy who has been lurking around that top five all the way through this tournament.
One of the guys you have got to keep your eye on right now, Kevin Van Dam, making a big charge for the lead. He said, I just want one shot on the last day, one shot at taking the title.
But right now, take a look at this. So far in this tournament, this has been the showstopper, the big story. Take a look at Randy Howell of Alabama fishing his spot in the northern part of the lake. Another Alabama angler, Gerald Swindle, about to move out of that same area. Asked for a signal from Howell, says he's coming through. It's a pretty good high rate of speed. He is going not excessively fast, but he's up on plane. He is disqualified for this, and the Bassmasters' Trip Weldon explains why.
I'm safe boating. I have videotape. I have received a call this morning from one of our photographers on the water. Randy Howell was fishing in the area, a lot of spectator boats, obviously media boats around Randy. He's one of our leaders after day one. And I received a phone call. I've got videotape evidence from, I think, Randy Howell's video guy, and I viewed it, and he just ran too close to non-competitor boats and competitor boats.
Take a look at this language right out of the rule book there. Really 2 points in the rules there. Safe boat conduct observed at all times. Not to do that results in disqualification and sportsmanship, especially with regard to any boating in the vicinity, not necessarily anglers. Reason for disqualification. You saw that. What did you think of that whole incident, Zach?
You know, I feel terrible for him. I feel terrible for Gerald Swindle right now. I know he's crushed with this, okay? But a rule is a rule. If the tournament director says, man, you did not practice safe boating, you got to remember something. There's more than competitors out here. There's non-competitors. There's spectators. He may have broke a rule on this one, and unfortunately, it's disqualification for the day.
Gerald Swindle, very flamboyant character. You don't think in any way because of who he is that rule was applied to him. It would have applied to any of these guys, right?
No, absolutely not. If 49 other guys would have done this, they would have been DQ'd, guaranteed. Trip Weldon is the fairest tournament director on the planet.
Gerald Swindle probably very unhappy right now. We hope to talk to him a little bit later. Right now, let's get back out to tournament action on Lay Lake. And Tommy Biffle, we saw him on top of the leaderboard right there. This is a guy who has been there so many times. He's had the second place finishes, but that also tells you how good he is.
Definitely, Tommy. And this is the one area we were talking about earlier in the show that could be susceptible to the bad weather that's coming. He's fishing off the main river. He's fishing a small tributary. And the reason why I say it's susceptible is mud. If we get a lot of rain, this is one area that a lot of mud could pour down. That could really affect it.
Tommy Biffle, we saw him catching good fish, had a slow start coming up today. Caught himself a good fish. Let's see if he can get something else going here. From Wagoner, Oklahoma, has been in this game a long time.
There's a good one. Come on, baby. Yeah. That's the kind I'm looking for right there.
As of right now, I would say Tommy Biffle not being affected by anything. That's probably the biggest spotted bass we've seen caught all tournament.
That is going to solidify his perch atop the leaderboard right there. Tommy Biffle looking very good at this moment. Let's take one more look at that leaderboard. Tommy Biffle there, 32 pounds and 5 ounces. That lead is starting to look really good, closing in on a 4-pound lead. Boyd Duckett and Randy Howell. Now we know the G-man, Gerald Swindle, is out of this competition here. That is a bombshell. Everyone, when they hear about this, is going to think twice about what's happening in this tournament right now. We got a lot more to come, plenty more on the way. When we come back, Kevin Van Dam, we know him as the hard-nosed competitor, but Kevin Van Dam fishing with a heavy heart this week, a friend in a bad accident, and in a tough way, very much on his mind. That when we come back.
There's nothing that I would love to do more than win this for Dave. It would make it by far the most special event of my whole career.
The 37th edition of the Bassmaster Classic, the World Championship of Bass Fishing. We're here on Lay Lake, Birmingham, Alabama. Tommy Biffle still the man atop the leaderboard there with lots of folks from Alabama giving chase. Remember, we haven't talked about this in a while. No one has ever won the Classic in their home state. That could change here in 2007. Going to take you out to the lake. One of our Alabama anglers, it's Randy Howell. He's been persevering all the way through this tournament. He's never slowed down for a minute. Tell us what he's doing, Z, and tell us what's under the water
there. You know, at first glance, right? There, it doesn't look like he's really fishing anything special, but Randy is really dialed in to this upper end of Lay Lake right now. The reason being, He's just not throwing a jig out and dragging it back. There's a ton, Tommy, there's a ton of trash out there, okay? I'm talking logs, laydowns, but more than anything, one of the biggest key, he's fishing a lot of rock.
He ain't very big, but we'll take him right in this minute. We'll take him right this minute. I needed that just for morale.
All right. From Randy Howe, we go over to Skeet Reese, also hanging in there in that top five leaderboard or thereabouts throughout the course of this tournament. There it is, Logan Martin Dam at the top of Lay Lake, and not too far from that dam is where Skeet has spent a lot of his time throughout this tournament.
He has. I mean, it really looks like we're seeing the same footage over and over, but these are actually different fish. And the one bait that, you know, you can't hammer enough right now, especially this time of year, is the jig, okay? And what these guys are trying to resemble fishing, this far up the river, they're trying to resemble crawfish. That right now is the primary forage for these spotted bass.
The jig is what we consider not so much a moving bait. It's not moved very much as opposed to a crankbait. The moving baits are a whole other philosophy on this lake.
Exactly. And what you're trying to do more than anything, you're just throwing this bait upstream, and you're not fishing it conventionally. You're kind of fishing it with the current. And this is going to sound crazy, but up in Michigan, that's how you fish for steelhead. You throw your bait up current, you let the current just flush it down real natural. That's exactly how these guys are catching them.
All right, Skeet Reese doing very, very well in this classic. It's been a while since he's won a tournament. Skeet Reese would love to add that classic to his resume. Another keeper looks like right there, so Skeet Reese has got things moving on. He's in a great mood. Let's talk about another one of our top competitors as we go through the competition on this second day, and that, of course, is Kevin Van Dam. Always hard-nosed, always a tough competitor. No one works harder than Kevin Van Dam, but in the back of Kevin Van Dam's mind, and many times in the front of it during this week, I know he's thinking about a special friend of his. One of his fans, one of his admirers, one of his friends involved in a terrible auto collision and in a tough situation right now, and Kevin Van Dam thinking about it very much, acting on his friendship. Take a look.
30 minutes away on Alabama's Big Talker, WEPI.
David Martin is an avid weekend angler, making his fifth annual classic road trip to watch his friend Kevin Van Dam. 11 hours earlier, he left Michigan with his wife Lori and their three children, Megan, Jake, and Anna.
Dad, how much farther?
But this journey actually began 9 months earlier on a back road in Kalamazoo, Michigan.
One of my best friends called me and basically said, your worst nightmare has come true. She said Dave has been in a car accident, and my heart just sunk.
We're close to heaven. Roger, I'll find you a cop.
We actually watched him take Dave off the helicopter and bring him into the hospital. And at that time, we really didn't give Dave much of a hope.
I thought, it's too late. He's gone.
Martin lay in a coma for 3 weeks. He occasionally responded to his wife's voice and the sounds of fishing tournaments playing on DVDs in his intensive care unit.
We played the reruns from the Elite Series last year, all the events, all the different Bassmaster shows we could get. They played constantly while he was in a coma.
I don't know necessarily that he could focus in on what we were showing him, but he was definitely listening, I believe.
When they came up, I remember him pretty well. I lay in bed and dream about fishing, and I dream a lot about walking.
Late last fall, Martin was released from the hospital. Paralyzed from the neck down, he vowed to be in Birmingham to see Van Dam compete for another classic win.
That he's been through, and for that to be one of the things that's on his mind most or whatever, to get here to the Bassmasters Classic, that's huge.
I love you.
This is a family that can show you what true love is all about, because that's this story.
And the thought of winning a classic in honor of his friend is enough to make the sport's tough guy reveal a side we've rarely seen.
There's nothing that I would love to do more than win this for Dave. It would make it by far the most special event of my whole career.
Got to meet Dave the other day. Fantastic fishing fan. Good friend of yours, too.
Definitely. You know, and watching that is That's pretty hard. That hits close to home. And more than anything, for the folks at home after watching that, is how well Dave has been doing the past 6 months. He's been doing incredible.
Very hopeful and got a great outlook for the future. All those around him have shared that outlook with him, and that's so important in a situation like that. A fantastic story. The Classic 2007 continues. Take another look at a leaderboard before we go to a break here. Tommy Biffle still hanging in there. Our Alabama gang still in there as well. Skeet Reese hanging there in the top five also. You got to make the top 25 to make it to championship day. We got a lot more on the way, including Steve and Julia Kennedy. This is a couple started out on the road. When you're young, it can be very, very hard, but they have persevered and gotten through it fine.
F10 and a 17-foot Bass Tracker aluminum boat. I fished out of that boat.
We'd pull into a place and we'd have to sleep in the car. You know, get your pillow and just lay over on the side of the door, set up the tent in the rain, take it down in the rain.
Even with the struggling financially, we're closer, much closer.
Bassmaster Classic 2007 continues. Big part of the experience for all the folks who come here for the Classic, the Bassmaster Classic Expo, sponsored by Under Armour, one of the greatest outdoor shows in all the world. A lot of competition out there, but this one's been around a long time, and this one is terrific. All the boats, all the tackle, all the gear. A wonderful, wonderful experience for everyone coming to the Classic. Take a look at the leaderboard. Moving day, elimination day. You got to land yourself in the top 25. The man landing himself on top of the leaderboard still. Oklahoma's Tommy Biffle, the veteran, has been around the block a few times. He's looking for his first Classic win. Randy Howe, Boyd Duckett of Alabama, in this thing as well. Look at that man, Terry Scroggins, man from Palatka, Florida, known for his sight fishing abilities more than anything else. Coming into last year's Classic in 2006, well, he's the man. He was the man to bet on because the sight fishing was going to be so prevalent down on Lake Toho. But I think we're proving here that he's beyond that. He's not a one-dimensional guy. He can catch him in a lot of different situations.
And that was one of the funny things that was said about Terry, you know, at the start of last year. A guy said, well, when he gets out of Florida, you know, he's going to get thrashed by his competition. Terry has done great. And more than anything, we talk about in the studio, all we talk, you know, guys fishing their strength. And I'm going to tell you, besides sight fishing, you see what he's doing right here? Flipping heavy matted vegetation. Woo! Terry Scroggins is probably one of the best in the entire country at doing this. And he's just not throwing a lure in this grass aimlessly. It is an absolute art. He's flipping into this with a very, very heavy weight, kind of punching through that grass. It's the best way to describe it. It's like dropping a bowling ball and then playing yo-yo with your bait. And kind of the best way to describe how a bite feels, it just feels like a sponge. But I will tell you one thing. This style of fishing produces better than average-sized bass.
Another keeper there for Terry Scroggins. He forges on, doing very well in this Classic 2007. Now our leader from day number one, Boyd Duckett from Demopolis, Alabama.
Now, right now, I'm trying to figure out what they're doing. Spots ought to be feeding with this cloud cover, you know. A lot of times we'll get around the brush and run these boat docks. We'll see if we get a bite or two. It'll tell us something.
And one of the most impressive, well, two of the most impressive things right now about Boyd Duckett, number one, the Kenny Rogers beard, and number two, how calm this guy is.
Well, there's one there, finally. One or two. Closer. Whew. They're not giants yet, but they're getting closer.
Boyd Duckett with probably the best results of any of this Alabama gang in the Classic so far, but another Alabama man who's really forging on, doing very well in this, is Steve Kennedy, the Rookie of the Year on the Bassmaster Elite Series for 2006. A rookie in name only. He's been around the fishing game for a long, long time. He started out with the humblest beginnings, but he and wife Julia have forged through it and made it a great journey along the way.
Oh, yeah, Dad, you might not want to do that.
5 years ago, when we first decided to go pro, this is it. S10 and a 17-foot Bass Tracker aluminum boat. I fished out of that boat 4 professional events.
It's been a long and bumpy road, but considering their accommodations the past 5 years, this recently purchased, previously owned motorhome truly is a palace to Steve Kennedy, his wife Julia, and their dog Louie.
When we started this, we put all of our stuff in storage, basically homeless. We'd pull into a place and we'd have to sleep in the car. You know, you get your pillow and just lay over on the side of the door. Set up the tent in the rain, take it down in the rain.
The last time we used the tent, we were down at Lake Okeechobee, and the wind blew 30, 40 miles an hour sustained, gust to 50 or 60. It ripped it to shreds. I mean, literally just flapping in the breeze.
And, you know, I've got the wet dog. I'm wet, cold, freezing, but we're all together.
Then from there, we bought a truck camper and been living out of that for 2 or 3 years now. Even then, you have to crawl up in the overhead part, and you can't even sit up straight. I mean, you bang your head every morning.
You have to camp for 5 years to really appreciate the fact that they have a shower. On the way back, we were in Arizona and got up, and I walked and took a hot shower. And then I walked out front and there was snow on the ground. And I came back and I was hugging on Steve because that was the first time in probably 5 years when we were out on the road that I didn't have to put shoes on, pack a bag, go hike to the shower, freeze, and then come back. So this is a pretty sweet deal.
Doing it this way, we actually get to travel together. We actually make time together. It's actually easier on our marriage, has been. Even with the struggling financially, we're closer, much closer. If we're going to do it together, we're not going to do it. I mean, that's the bottom line.
Bye.
Wow. All right, Steve Kennedy, good story right there. Let's take a look at that leaderboard one more time. Tommy Biffle still hanging on top there. Steve Kennedy, the man in sixth place right now. He's going to be a shoe-in to make the top 25. Michael Iaconelli on that list as well. One of our Federation Nation anglers in there, Terry McWilliams, too. Kevin Wirth. Looks like he's going to make the top 25.
And definitely, Kevin Wirth said coming to this tournament, he's catching 20 to 30 a day. But Kevin's biggest problem so far, he said, I'm not catching a lot of big bass.
Russ Lane, a big favorite coming in, had fallen out of that top 25. He's kind of crawled his way back in there, but there's still fishing yet to come. He can still be caught, bumped back out of this thing.
The surprising thing in this tournament right now, though, is some of the names that are really struggling to get in that cut line. We got guys like Rick Klun, Ishman Rowe right now, but the one thing Ish got on his side, he's only got one fish. If he can stack it with four more, he'll be right in there.
Edwin Evers, another favorite coming in, languishing there near the bottom of the leaderboard. Chris Novak, another one of the Federation Nation anglers, not with such good luck this time around. All right, we're going to come back a little bit later. When we do, man, we've got some great stuff to share with you. But the big story, the bombshell of this event so far, Gerald Swindle, big favorite from Alabama, with this move right here, is disqualified on the basis of his voting. We'll be back with more on that. Bassmaster Classic 2007, the 37th Bassmaster Classic being contested here on Lay Lake near Birmingham, Alabama. 3 days of competition, full field for the first 2 days. We're right in the middle of that second day of competition. We'll eliminate 25 at the weigh-in coming up a little bit later here, so stay with us. Tommy Biffle, Boyd Duckett, Randy Howe, Terry Scroggins, Kevin Van Dam now making his move. Had a tough day number one, but he is getting back into this thing right now. Kevin Van Dam, the superstar of bass fishing, never to be counted out, and he's proving it once again. You always keep your eyes on Van Dam. So good to have you with us here. The biggest event in all the world of bass fishing, the championship of the world for bass fishing. And this is a big one. $500,000 to the winner. This thing gets bigger and bigger every year. Now it's being seen in 66 countries.
Definitely, Tommy. And one of the key things happening in this tournament right now, you got to pay attention to this, is the late day bite. It happened on day one and it's happening right now.
All right, things are changing, rapidly moving on that leaderboard again. We're moving closer and closer to weigh-in time. But the big story so far, the bombshell story so far, take a look at this. Angler Randy Howell of Alabama sitting in his spot, northern part of the lake right there. Take a look at Gerald Swindle, another one of the big favorites coming out of Alabama. Very flamboyant guy. He says he's gonna move right through the crowd there, and he does. Very, very close to some other boats, including Randy Howell's camera boat. Group of spectators, and based on that move right there, Gerald Swindle is disqualified by tournament director Trip Weldon. Safety is cited there. You can be disqualified if you don't observe safety rules. That was a ruling, sportsmanship, which involves conduct of your boat around people who aren't fishing in the tournament. Both of those elements conspired to have Gerald Swindle taken out of this thing. And Gerald Swindle, a lot of fans, especially since this classic is being contested here in Birmingham, Alabama, huge number of fans here. This thing is going through the building like wildfire. People are shocked.
I know we both feel terrible for Gerald right now, but let's say this again. Trip Weldon, the tournament director, he did receive a complaint. A rule is a rule, and unfortunately, it's a complete day's disqualification.
All right, Gerald Swindle will wait again, and he'll be back again another day. You can count on that. He's a very dejected person right now. We hope to talk to him a little bit later on in our broadcast. Right now, big tournament going on, still going on, out on Lay Lake. We take you out for a look at Ish Monroe. Ish Monroe, who joined the 100-pound club last year with 4 days of fishing on Lake Amistad.
Come on, couple four-pounders.
Big one, big one.
I need that one. I needed that one.
And one thing you have to pay attention to right here is how diverse this lake is, okay? We see guys fishing all the way up at the dam throwing jigs. Ish Monroe right here throwing a spinnerbait. Guys flipping heavy grass. Tons of different techniques happening right now.
Ish Monroe has been on a flurry there. He's filled his live well with bass now, and he's back in this thing right now.
Good old Hildebrand spinnerbait.
Back over to Tommy Biffle, our tournament leader in this second day of competition. Tommy Biffle from Wagner, Oklahoma, the master of fishing the jig.
He does 3 and 4 pounders. A lot of ounces matter in this tournament. I hate not to be out there on that current, but too many boats running up and down in the thing. Well, the river's got so much traffic in it right now, and the bite's way off. I'm just trying to get out of the pressured areas and get out of the boat traffic. I've caught some good ones in here in pre-practice. So I came in here, and there seemed to be biting in here, but I've only caught one good one. I need to catch several good ones. But, you know, just trying to get out of the stream of boats. Now there's several boats in here, so I don't know. It's Saturday. And I know there's some 3 and 4 pounders back here. Just have to get them to bite. Pretty good fish, maybe. Still land for eel on him. Reckon that eel get to weigh him in.
All right, the last time the Classic was contested here on Lay Lake, we watched Jay Yellis battle all kinds of boat traffic. That was the height of summer. Pontoon boats, ski boats running through his area and everything. He persevered on through that. This kind of thing is playing on Tommy Biffle's mind on this Saturday.
Well, it is. You know, you see him culling right here. He's culling out his smaller fish. He's upgrading his catch. You got to give him credit on that. But the best way to put it right now, his best defense is a better offense. He's avoiding the crowds, Tommy. And more than anything, we're going to see this transpire big time tomorrow if the weather permits. If the weather lets spectators get out, guaranteed one of the guys in our top five is going to be highly affected by all the boat traffic.
All right, what are the bad effects that a big bunch of traffic can have on guys fishing?
Well, the obvious, if they just decide to start fishing with you.
Okay? That's a tough one right there.
That's a big time negative. But another one is if they start running their depth finders, it's a lot of noise.
All right, we look for that tomorrow. Tommy Biffle, the man still on top of the board right now. Skeet Reese making the move up the board. He's still 4 pounds behind Tommy Biffle at this point. Our Alabama gang is hanging in there pretty well, having lost Gerald Swindle, however, to disqualification. That is a huge story here at this Classic. Day number 2. You got to be in the top 25 at the end of this day. And we got more fishing on the way, about an hour and a half's worth. So stay with us. When we come back, the great story of Takahiro Omori. No money, didn't speak English, but he had a dream. A kid in Tokyo who wanted to be a professional bass fisherman.
I said, I'm going to the United States to try to be the professional bass fisherman. And my parents said, you crazy? My parents always said, hey, go to college. Then you got to think about it.
Weather wreaked havoc at the 2006 Classic in Kissimmee, Florida. On the event's final day, pouring rain and brutal winds forced most anglers to shelter.
Whoever wins today,
They earned it.
Luke Clawson was able to fight through the rain and capture his first Classic championship.
Persistence won it for me, you know, staying out there fishing that same water and really trying to focus on one group of fish and knowing it's the right size fish if I can get the bites.
During his wire-to-wire win, Clawson, the youngest competitor in the field, set the record for the heaviest winning weight in a Classic.
Luke Clawson, the most recent champ of the Classic. Let's take a look at those Classic winners from the last few years. Back in 1997, Dion Hibden, Takahiro Omori. We'll hear more from him just a little bit later today. Michael Iaconelli certainly making a play in this field. Kevin Van Dam as well. So we got some Classic champs making some big noise here. Let's talk about the big noise that's been made during day number two of this Classic, beginning with Boyd Duckett, our day one leader.
I had one.
They're not giants yet, they're getting closer.
Dean Rojas didn't have a spectacular day number one, trying to hang there in day number two, not using his friend Kermit the Frog, but using a jerk bait.
Another big one. Another big one. There you go.
And a California native, Skeet Reese, who said before this tournament began, I am having the worst Classic practice of my entire life. Right now, Skeet Reese in high contention to win the whole thing.
You always look out for the guy who says his practice is going terribly.
And the man you have to watch right now, Terry Scroggins from Florida.
Woo. All right.
Terry Scroggins was a big favorite for last year's Classic, hanging in there this year. How about Randy Howell, one of the big hopefuls for Alabama? Randy Howell doing very, very well, consistent every hour of this Classic so far. And how about this incident right here? Gerald Swindle leaving the hole that Randy Howell's in, up on plane, goes right through that crowd right there on the basis of that boat action. He is disqualified from the Classic. That. Timmy Horton, another Alabama man.
Two of them. Look at here. Two of them. Two of them, 2 4-pounders. Unbelievable. Unbelievable.
Unbelievable.
Oh my goodness, if that ain't the way to start a day. Look at this. Very rarely do you land both of them when that happens.
You just hit a gold mine right there.
All right, that's what's gone on so far. Let's take a look at the leaderboard right there. Still Tommy Biffle on top. Kevin Van Dam streaking toward the top of that leaderboard right there. Our Alabama gang hanging in there very well. One man, a former Classic champ, who is not looking so good to make the top 25 would be the 2004 Classic champ, Takahiro Omori. An inspirational story if ever there was one. With Takahiro Omori, of course, he came to this United States with no money, no way to speak the language. He had one dream, and that was to become a professional bass angler. You talk about a guy with perseverance. The story of Tak is truly inspirational.
I love bass fishing so much. Only in America you can do this for a living. So I came here, I was 21 years old, then culture is totally different. I miss all my family, my Japanese food. Americans like, you know, yeah, you see? Japanese, very calm, quiet.
From the silence of downtown Tokyo to a typical encounter in this bait shop in tiny Emory, Texas.
You showed me to use the little old blue and black jig with the little old
Takahiro Omori has literally come halfway around the world to find fortune and fame. Omori came to America with no money, alone, and unable to speak English. He left his country against the wishes of his family.
Then my parents said, you crazy? My parents never paid me any money to come to the United States to fish. Look at this camper right here. This is the only one I could afford it. It was 1965 Flora camper. This was my house 6 years on this. Every time
to earn a living, he guided here. His clientele? Mostly vacationing Japanese couples.
The honeymoon couple. Yeah.
Really?
They came all the way to here to fish Lake Fork like 3 days, then go to Florida to see the Mickey Mouse. I'm not kidding, they go to Disney World.
Today, Omori laughs often, and why not? He surpassed $1 million in career earnings in 2006, but he still travels alone on tour.
Sometimes, you know, you feel a little bit lonely and You know, my age, most of the guy has a wife. You know, I help them, or maybe got kids. Got one. This is not little.
At this point in my life, I just put 100% everything for fishing.
No girlfriend?
Not right now. I'm looking for one now.
Yes, I hear. Just see this. Just see this. This is Lake Fork bass I've been catching last 10 years. See how big it is? I'm gonna get one of those at the Classic.
Great story right there. And really, if you think about it, the odds stacked against him, one of the best stories in bass fishing.
First international winner of the Bassmaster Classic. He takes all the distractions out of his life. There is not a human being on this earth more dedicated to the sport of bass fishing than Takahiro Omori. We've got much, much more on the way. When we come back, we will hear from the man, Gerald Swindle, disqualified for his boat actions earlier today in day number two.
Environment that I play the game in, and the speed is extremely fast. To me, it was just another day at the office. To everybody else, it was dangerous.
The Bassmaster Classic 2007, getting down to the final minutes of fishing here. Tommy Biffle, the man still hanging on to this lead. Of course, all these weights are unofficial. They won't be real until they hit the scales at the weigh-in. And the weigh-in is coming up soon in our coverage. Kevin Van Dam, all the way from 19th to second place unofficially, the biggest move of the day. One of the big buzzes around here, especially in the arena where the weigh-in's taking place. Hey, the women are a big part of it this year. The Women's Bassmaster Tour holding their tour championship on Lake Mitchell, not too far away. And there's your champ right there, Pam Martin Wells, a couple of great fish from Lake Mitchell right there. She has knocked them out this week. A fantastic week of fishing. The women gaining a lot of traction, a lot of ground, and a lot of fans in the inaugural year of the Women's Bassmaster Tour. Pam Martin Wells on top, Sherry Glasgow, Juanita Robinson, and all the rest in there. Congratulations to them. A successful first season. Of course, the big bombshell throughout the entire Classic community, the disqualification of Gerald Swindle, one of the most popular figures. Lots of fans here for him at this Classic, an Alabama angler who was threatening to win this thing. But this move right here with his boat out on Lay Lake, well, this ended his Classic for him. Take a look at what exactly happened out there. Randy Howell fishing in the spot he's been occupying most of this Classic competition. Gerald Swindle fishing in the same area. Now take a look at this. Gerald Swindle will signal to him that he wants to come through there. The boat is up on plane, and this is what happens.
Yeah, he shouldn't have done that.
So he continues on through there.
And at this point right here, Tommy, Gerald Swindle goes on with his day, business as usual, man. He does not know in his head right here, he is out of the competition.
Oh, come on. Come on.
Let's go with it.
Woo! Yes! You want it! You arrived! Yes! Woo! Yeah! Woo! You believe I just got a fish over 4 pounds? Yeah! I lost my voice, dude. Freaking lost my voice. Oh my God! I've been telling you all day. And anybody watching at home, you watch this show, I knew I had to catch a 3-pounder to be in contention to even fish tomorrow. Now, I've dug myself a hole.
Don't call me and send me to call trip.
Again? I done talked to you one time.
He stayed in the last 30 minutes.
Yeah, I'm not sure it caught him totally by surprise. I told him he had been disqualified for violations of rules 5I, 6I, and he said, I understand, it was your call. I respect your decision. He said, I thought I was doing the right thing, going the way he did. And I said, Gerald, you should have battled through all of those boats.
God. Why didn't they call me earlier and make that decision instead of like making me fish and do all that? I got disqualified. I got disqualified for running by you. Yes, I just got disqualified. I've never been disqualified.
He was pretty upset, you know, and he should be, because this is the Bassmaster Classic. He had a good string today, and he'd have been in contention to win tomorrow, and so that's a bad deal.
Said it's unsportsmanlike conduct. They watched the media, said it was dangerous driving, and I said, Randy motioned me on, but Tripp's like, if I waved you a red light, would you go?
The environment that I play the game in and the speed is extremely fast. To say that if you and I went and batted against John Smoltz tomorrow, it's going to seem pretty fast, ain't it? To Rafael Fercalis, it's going to be another pitch, right? to me, it was just another day at the office. To everybody else, it was danger. So my mind didn't process it like that. I made a mistake, and I'm done.
He's so popular, he plays so hard, it has cost Gerald Swindle this time around. One more look at the leaderboard with the fishing about wrapped up. Tommy Biffle on top, Kevin Van Dam with the big move. Who's going to make the top 25? We have the weigh-in coming up when we come back. All the pageantry, all the excitement, a big day. Who are the anglers who will fish the final championship day of the Bassmaster Classic 2007? We'll weigh them in. We'll make it legal. We'll see who gets to go on when we come back.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of the Bassmaster Classic is brought to you by the all-new Toyota Tundra, the truck that's changing it all. Motor Guy, never stop. Lowrance, we lead, we find, you win. And by Triton Boats, we take America fishing.
Bassmaster Classic 2007 and the huge story on this day number two action. Gerald Swindle of Alabama, one of the favorites here. And Randy Howell fishing his spot on Lay Lake. There's Gerald Swindle about to leave the area. Gets a signal from Randy Howell, then takes off through this group of people, which include a camera boat, some spectator boats. Looked very close. There was a complaint. Subsequently, there was a ruling that Gerald Swindle would be disqualified. Bass cites several things, the safety of the competitors and the safety, the boating safety being recognized as grounds for disqualification, also the respect for non-angling spectators out there. Gerald Swindle joins us right now. Gerald, I want your side of the story. Tell us what we just saw there.
I mean, you pretty much summed it up. We were working up and down the river, and to keep from cutting each other off, you have to go in front and drift back. And I was getting ready to move up in front of Randy, and I made a split second decision, Tommy, to run the gap. I've seen the flotilla. Randy was against the bank, and I guess my mind as an angler, I'm just looking at it from a fisherman's standpoint for what Randy thinks. You know, stay out of Randy's way, and he's like, come on, and I'm like, I made that decision. And I'll live with it. That you know, to me, I didn't feel unsafe. But looking at the footage, a lot of people out there probably see this very unsafe. And you know, I made a decision. I'll live with it. I guess you just get programmed into that. That you just, you know, you're just trying to hustle up and win, and the adrenaline's pumping. And bad call, man, for me.
If the roles were reversed and Randy did that and came that close, are you going to talk to Randy at the weigh-in about that at all?
Absolutely not.
It's all good.
If Harvick and Earnhardt Jr. run neck and neck to the finish line, they're going to talk to each other. So as a competitor, we see the game at a different speed. You see it as in, you know, one thing you see ironic there is how we process thoughts. If you'll see Randy motion me, where did his eyes go to next? Back on the water, because he fully trusts my judgment that I'm going to stick that boat in there. Well, I disallowed the safety of other people, and which was foolish on my part, and I done it. So my instincts overrode good thinking, and it cost me a deal. And you know, I wouldn't do it again in any kind of way. You know, I hate it for Tripp. He had to make the call. Hate it for the fans who come out there to watch us. I don't promote you know, unsafe boat driving in any kind of way. However, a lot of times how we drive and blast off, you guys have seen it. I mean, these guys will drive them like they stole them. They'll run them in the ground, and you know, got to lay off the adrenaline a little bit.
Thank you very much, Gerald Swindle. Gerald Swindle out of the Classic. Unbelievable. This is huge. We forward now to the Classic, and of course, disqualified or not, they're going to let Gerald Swindle weigh in. This guy's too much of a fan favorite.
Well, and not only that, man, that's as sincere as it can. The guy messed up right there, broke a rule, and more than anything, really in contention to win this tournament. He ended up having a great day, too. True heartbreak.
All right, Gerald. Get him overboard right now. 25th place.
I just want to apologize to my sponsors.
Gerald, we're proud of the man that you are, and you have done a phenomenal job as an ambassador of this sport.
So when everybody here know, I didn't cheat. I didn't try to cheat. I wasn't trying to gain an edge. I made a simple judgment error.
How about it one more time for Gerald Swindle, ladies and gentlemen?
An emotional departure from the classic stage for Gerald Swindle. You can bet he will be back, and he will be back to win the thing. Let's take a look at the other highlights from the classic. Coming in, one of those Alabama hopefuls, Timmy Horton. We saw he had that great start today. Brings in 29 pounds, 11 ounces. He's in fifth place.
Your day one leader, another Alabama angler, Boyd Duckett, right now probably the biggest dark horse in our top five, sitting with 30 pounds, 13 ounces.
The man who was supposed to win the Bassmaster Classic last year, 2006, Terry Scroggins, fell a little short there. Maybe he got his years mixed up. He is solid in this one. A great campaign he's putting together. 30 pounds, 15 ounces for Terry Scroggins.
And the man from California who said, you know what, Tommy? I'm going to have a terrible classic. I've had a brutal practice session, finding himself right now staring down the barrel of $500,000, 32 pounds, 6 ounces, Skeet Reese.
Now the man, KBD.
Three-time Angler of the Year, two-time Bassmaster Classic Champion, Kalamazoo, Michigan's Kevin Van Dam. KBD, arguably the most dangerous man in the sport. Let me help you with that. One, two, three, four. Oh, boy. Get a look at this, ladies and gentlemen. You better get your cameras ready with both barrels. Bang, bang! Let's let the pictures do the talking right now. Kevin Van Dam, five fish, yes, 6 and 20/30, 19.6 out of the lead, 19 pounds, 14 ounces, KBD right back up top. Woo! Where are you, Birmingham? Give it up for Kevin Van Dam. Moves to the top of the leaderboard.
This is the way into the final day of competition at the Classic.
Kevin Van Dam with a 5 pound, 7 ounce Pure Later Big Bass of the day. And he's got a few words for us to tell us kind of what he's thinking going into the final day of the tournament.
Fortunately, that's a great position to be in. You know, that's what we all dream about, you know, being in contention to win, going to the last day of the Bassmasters Classic. I mean, it's what I live for. You know, I couldn't have scripted today much better.
All right, let's take a look at the leaderboard. The man leading the way into the final day, championship day, is Kevin Van Dam. 32 pounds, 15 ounces, came all the way from 19th place after the first day of competition.
We need to make note right here, Gerald Swindle would have ended up in 12th place if not for that disqualification. But on that side of it, right now, going into the final day of competition, five guys are within 3 pounds of the lead. That is exactly what the Bassmaster Classic is all about.
All right, Ish Monroe, he's in it. That man, Kevin Worth, is in it as well as we go down the line. 25th place is the cutoff if you're not in 25th. And there's the man, wow. Russ Lane from Alabama, just squeaks in. He's going to compete in the final day of this Bassmaster Classic. And we look at the ones who did not get there, some of the pre-tournament favorites, guys like Greg Hackney. Edwin Evers is also among that group. As we take a look at the next page, Bill Lowen, coming a long way and then falling at the last minute. Peter Tilveros and Takahiro Amori, 2004 but Classic winner.
Some of the legends that did not make it with us for the last day, Rick Klun, Kelly Jordan, Denny Brower of all people, not going to be with us on the final day of competition.
Well, the final day of competition will be huge. Once again, this is the World Championship of Bass Fishing. $500,000 to the winner. We'll have it all for you. Our coverage starts at 8:30 a.m. Eastern time on Sunday with plenty of live updates and then the full story, full coverage of the final round of the Bassmaster Classic starts at 10 p.m. Eastern time on ESPN2. You need to mark it down because you need to be here for that. What are your thoughts? What's going to happen on this final day? Hard to predict.
Well, you know what? There's really one thing that sticks out right now. What I look at going into the final day of competition, I look at guys that increase their weights from day one to day two. In our top 10, there's three guys right now that stick out. Steve Kennedy caught a great sack on day two. Gary Klein, and more so than anything, Kevin Van Dam. Those three guys really caught him better than they did on day one.
10th place is 5 pounds back in this classic. Can someone come that far and make,
absolutely. I mean, Kevin Van Dam was, you know, we're talking 19th place. Now he's in the lead. It is anybody's ball game.
All right. It's going to be great stuff, and we will see you next time. We're going to take you out with some views of what happened out there in round number two. Some smashing stuff out there. Hard-nosed competition. All good. And the best is yet to come. Round three, and we will see you there.